Welcome into the Jam Happy Hour. Hope you're having a wonderful afternoon, evening, wherever the time may be where you're joining us to sip on some delish wines, get to know some new music, and maybe even a new artist for your favorites playlist. Today we're being joined by Tatiana DeMaria, coming in from LA. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thanks for having me.
What's been kind of cool about our Jam Happy Hours is your fans get to know us and our fans get to know you, and we get to hang out and enjoy your music for an hour. So I always say cheers to that.
And cheers to that.
If someone is just experiencing you for the very first time here with us this afternoon, the Jam Happy Hour, I hate asking genres, but what kind of feelings is your music going to give us today?
Well, I think we're just going to have to listen and find out, aren't we?
I love that. And that's a great way to kick it off. So, what song would you like to play for us first?
You know what? I'm going to open with probably a song called Road to Paradise. Let's do that.
All right. That sounds perfect. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you. What's up, everyone? Hang on. Sorry, I've got to take these off when I'm playing. Also, I just saw, I can also see these. Fuck yeah, what's up? Comments? Okay. We're in the zone now, my bad. No one's paved the road to paradise or guaranteed that it could be nice. It's just a long road, I'd roll dragging a red wagon, stewing 6 feet under, wondering what the fuck you're right on the way to my time. Go, time's in like you've got to take a chance and dance on broken glass and see you laugh. What's up, Ashley Jackson? Sarah Elizabeth Holmes. Lovers tortured, lovers killed, lovers saved a million still. For all we need, two lungs, one heart, to face the troubles life does part. To waste a second, breath your dealt, take it, hold it, make it felt. Wasted life, one wasted you, wasted prospects, idols too. You're on the mind. You're better off alone. No alibi. No opera. No one spared the road to paradise. Oh, guarantee that it be nice. It's just a long hard road dragging a little red wagon still. 6 feet under, wondering what the fuck if I don't wait my time. The time's in like you gotta take a chance and dance on broken glass and see you laugh. How we all doing, people? Last night I had a dream. I went to a golden place, a place I didn't recognize. So feel about let me in. He says I don't have faith. He says I don't believe. I don't believe. That's right, Chuck. SP, hey. 21st Pilot, Leon Domer, good to see you. All right, let's kick this show off right to start with. Come on, first song in. Let's go arena, people. Love is tortured, love is stupid, love is saving me and still a row. We need to love them all to face the troubles like this part. Don't waste a second, break it up, we'll take it, hold it, make it felt. One wasted love, one wasted you, wasted prospects, idols too. Love is tortured, love is stupid, love is saving me and still a row. We need to love them all to face the troubles like this part. Don't waste a second, break it up, take it, hold it, make it felt. One wasted love, one wasted you, wasted prospects, idols too. No one's scared that road to paradise or guaranteed that it could be nice. It's just that long road, hard road, dragging the little red wagon, still with 6 feet under, wondering what the fuck if I don't wait my time. Go, time's in life, you gotta take a chance and dance on. lies. You're on the mice. You're better off alone. No compromise.
Oh, 21st Pilot tuning in at work.
I love the comments. I love everybody jumping in right away. Road to Paradise here with Tatiana DeMaria in the Jam Happy Hour. I think you and I are probably a little like-minded from what I can tell already. Those lyrics are awesome. How, when you go to write your music, are you hearing like the story first or are you hearing like the music first? I'm always curious.
Oh, it depends. It can kind of be anything. And I think I built a songwriting course for songwriters a while ago because I found that so many people start songs in different ways and so many people have different places they get stuck. So this song I actually wrote when I was 15, and what I had of the song was this. And I knew I really liked it, and I had just gotten like my first laptop. And so I started to build the song, and it turned into a 7-minute song and then a 9-minute song. And there was just so much in it that came off that riff that inspired me to write. So then I had to really whittle it the fuck down to a 3.5-minute song. And then
it could have been a 9-minute opus by the time you were done.
I still think the 7-minute version is great. So it ended up being one of the singles off my first album, and it was just fun to throw it back a bit.
That's really kind of interesting that, you know, a song that you remember, you know, grabbing that riff and realizing that it was something and something that you wanted to hang on to and something that you wanted to build off of, even at the age of 15. Like, I can't even tell you what I was into at the age of 15. And yet you knew in that moment, you're like, no, this is something and I need to hang on to it. At what age did you realize that you were going to be like musical?
Oh gosh. Okay. I wrote the whole first album at 15, 16. So I think by that point it was cemented, the Soho Lights album from my band Tat, which is on Spotify. But when I was 9, I remember just thinking Michael Jackson had his first hit at 10. Like, I've got 1 year. I wasn't playing an instrument. I wasn't writing music. It was just a really weird thought in my head. But something I've talked about a bit is also just having synesthesia in four or five, six different forms. Wow. And one of them being music. And bad music makes, to me, it's all subjective. But music I don't like or resonate with makes me feel a bit nauseous and seasick and frustrated, whereas good music can be like a face massage or an arm massage and different physical sensations. So I think it's always been this thing that's brought me sanity, brought me to myself. Right. And that I grew up, you know, obviously because I started young, I would see musicians talk about it's super cathartic and it's helpful. And I was like, I don't know, it's just fucking fun and cool.
And I'm just doing it because, you know, I'm 9 and I've got to get there.
Well, it's also, I had severe anxiety when I was about 12, 13 and started going to therapy then. And I remember that music was just the thing that saved my life. And I remember this moment of going, holy fuck, this is the cure to everything. I have to share it. I have to make music. And it was a very innocent way of starting to then properly write music. Then that became the main thread for me. It really is about sharing truths, being as honest as you possibly can so that others can relate. And I guess now I've thought of an answer to your first question, which is I would love for my music to give people the courage to be themselves relentlessly, to want to take all their clothes off and run down the street feeling fucking free and aligned in themselves. And I think that's probably what I'd like to do as a life, as a person on this planet, is help anyone in that, including myself.
Oh, there's so many veins in what you just said. I mean, all these kids today are dealing with so much anxiety, so much anxiousness and uncertainty. And I think that a lot of people do dive into music for that sense of sanity or that sense of just like maybe forgetting for a few minutes. But like for you, it was a different kind of a therapy because it actually quieted your brain, because it actually gave you that creative energy to plug into. And you talk about synesthesia. And the only time I've ever really experienced any of that was with Charlie XCX. And she has it in a very visual way. And so she sees different colors, and you talk about, you know, different feelings. And I find all of that incredibly interesting, that some people would maybe be afraid to dive into it, but you were like, nah, head first, let's go. Let's see where, you know, where this is going to go and how it's going to help other people, which maybe is why it comes across so entirely authentic.
That's very kind of you and I appreciate it. Thank you. And it's funny because I didn't know I had synesthesia. I didn't think about it. I also see colors for letters, days of the week, words. I get words and flavor sensations, balances. I have spatial. So I have a few different things, but the point was that when I would communicate with people, because they would be in different forms, I remember saying to a friend, like, what color is your Wednesday? And she was like, what do you mean? And I was like, you know, mine's green. What's yours? And she was actually the one who pointed it out to me, and it was not that long ago. And I was like, what the fuck do you mean? So I went and started looking it up, and I was like, shit, this is why everyone was laughing at me when I'd see a big green wall and like have to go put my face in it. And my bandmates used to always take the piss and be like, get over yourself. And I'm like, I can't.
It's a thing.
But I didn't realize. So anyway, it's been nice to come full circle and yeah.
Have it make some sense. My Wednesday's yellow, by the way.
Yes. Amazing. You have synesthesia colors for days of the week?
I think, I don't know if it's like the full on, but I always attach to things and they'll never go away. So it's like, you know, for me, like a Wednesday is always kind of a yellow. It's not too hot. It's not too cold. You're halfway there. You know, you can get through anything. Weekends are more like my greens, my chill, my calm, my blues. Mm-hmm. Mondays are more reds and oranges and everything's a little crazy. So it makes sense to me. Like, I get it. So the fact that you can explain it so well, you know, maybe you're actually helping other people kind of figure out the same thing too, because as a creative, and you are very much a creative, to have that, all those different layers to go along with it too, does it ever feel kind of overwhelming sometimes?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm very, very sensitive as a human. You know, I was talking about this recently, that, you know, sensitivity and insecurity are two very different things. You know, you can be very sensitive, and I don't take much personally, but at the same time, you can be not very sensitive and take everything personally. So it is about self and boundaries, right. But the sensitivity I'm referring to is a very strong empathy, and, you know, sense, intuition, sometimes getting psychic vision. So there's a bit of that overlap, and that I think can be overwhelming. You know, I've experienced times in life where I've just been like, fucking hell, that feels like so much is going on, but I don't think this is my energy. You know, picking up on other people's energies and understanding those boundaries and differences.
Empath, kind of a place where you're taking on everything else that's happening.
Yeah. And then learning to manage. So I think, you know, being in therapy at a young age for many reasons, you know, I think that it's been a process of managing emotions, and I've gotten to a place in life where my capacity for management is very large, because I've spent a lot of time working on it, but it's also a fine line before you burn yourself out. So it's really learning that, I think.
I think I'm gonna have to go back and like transcribe this interview at some point, because I'm loving everything that you're saying. It's like,
that makes
a lot of sense. I can relate to that. And the beauty of it is your music is doing that for some people. And do you ever stop and think about, I mean, you say you want to create this music that makes people feel a better way or a certain kind of way, but here you are doing it and you've been doing it. And, you know, whether it was like originally with the band or now doing the solo stuff too, like, I love the idea of when you put a song out, it becomes whatever it's supposed to be. It's like, it's your baby until it's out there. Yeah. And now with technology, I mean, pre-pandemic, but even post-pandemic, you can release music off your phone in the drop of a button and it's out into the world. How does that feel for you when that song is gone and out and flying?
My fans are pretty pissed at me that I haven't released something in a minute. So they're going to take reading that really too. Personally. But like, fuck's sake. I have a song coming out actually in a couple of weeks, which I haven't officially announced yet. But anyone who's in here, and I see some diehards in here, the 19th of May, there will be another track coming out. And it is a wonderful feeling. I think people can relate now in the sense of content. You put out content, you don't know what's going to go viral. You don't know what people are going to relate to. And that's the same with music. And I'm actually a huge proponent of just consistently release music. Because I write my music and I produce my music, and I play everything in the music generally, bar like sometimes bringing my bassist on or sometimes bringing a drummer in, it means that the workload can be quite heavy and I've been moving a bit slowly. I've also started a big Web3 company that I founded with my co-founder to reshape the music industry, the music economy. So using crypto, Web3 and AI. And so balancing those is a lot. All
three
of that
very
to say,
scary words, you know, to a lot of people, but you're, I want to get into that. I do want to, but I'm just like, wow, a lot of people tend to shy away from that. And you're just, you're face first into it. Like, how can I use this to make it better?
Yeah. Living life face first. But I do think that, you know, they are scary. There is very, AI is earth shattering. And what we do is we don't do language models that kind of teach themselves in the same conversational ways, but we do things that change musicians' lives for the better. And our whole thing is data for good, Web3 for good, just building for good, because you can build for good and make a profit at the same time. And I think that in our world, things get too skewed, too for profit, too for good, but people shy away from this middle where actually you can create movements and change. And I think that we see that the most with creators online. People mm-hmm. who are actually just starting by posting value end up building audiences and end up having these sustainable businesses. I realize I just sidetracked and went, yeah.
No, I've heard it called philanthropic profitability. And by doing good and by trying to do good, you can also build a brand that will also make you money. And I don't think that's a bad thing if people are sharing, you know?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Speaking of sharing, I told you it's the fastest hour in music. We are almost 20 minutes in and you've played
right.
a song. And Sarah is not happy with me. She's like, please be quiet and let this girl play a song. Sarah Elizabeth. She's being very sweet. She says 100% worth the wait. So what
Hi,
song
Sarah
would you
Elizabeth.
Like to play for us next?
That's a good question. Also, anyone who's in here, feel free to throw any recommendations,
there
requests.
Challenge.
You know what? I think I'm a bit hoarse today, so I'm going to... See, I'm hoarse because I was fucking recording something for you guys.
Oh, there you go. Take your headphones off.
Good point. Thank you.
Sisterhood.
Sarah Elizabeth. Twisted Thorn. Is that the right key? I don't think so. There we go. Twisted Thorn. In my sight, show me no mercy. How I've cried, no river of tears washed me clean. Lay down your arms, my love. I beg of you, go easy on my heart. I'll be yours for so long, and I'll still be seeing things through your eyes, seeing things through your smile, seeing things through your lies, seeing things. No, I don't mind no seeing things through your eyes, seeing things through your smile. I'll take more than just your honest mistakes, yeah, and I'll let. Yes, I still care. How I loved you, how you loved me too. How we reached the forget our past so soon and told each other through the very same seams. And I'll still be seeing things through your eyes, seeing things through your smile, seeing things through your lies, seeing things. No, I don't mind no seeing things through your eyes, seeing things through your smile. I'll take more than just your honest mistakes, yeah, and I'll let, 'cause I still care. And I'll break for more than just your honest mistakes, yeah. And I lay, 'cause I still care. I care. Yeah, I still care. I care.
Hoarseness works in that one, Honest Mistakes. That is
thanks.
That is fantastic. I really like how the lyrics, as we've discussed, it you can find your own story in them quite easily, you know, and my story will attach to your story, whatever story you were thinking of when, you know, when you wrote that song, and, you know, for everybody else too. It's a really cool way to kind of it sounds hokey. Share in the loneliness, share in the mistakes, share in the sadness, but also by doing so, you're no longer alone and you're no longer sad. Does
yeah,
that make sense?
I love that. Beautifully said. I think that, you know, no man is an island, and I think we've survived as a human race in community, and actually the individualism is beautiful and we support it, and I want that for everybody, but it's also not necessarily what's helped us thrive and survive as a species. And I think that coming together is so important. And there are very few things that bring us together in the world today. I think that that's part of the success of American Idol or Pop Idol, is much like the moon landing, you know, everybody tuned into the moon landing and everybody shared in an experience together.
Right.
And Pop Idol, I think people love being a part of something. And I think music is so powerful to me, and has the power to, when you're feeling sad, give your sadness meaning. When you're feeling joyful, like, help you fucking explode and express it and not be alone and find new friends. I have a social club, like a fan club, and I love seeing the community in there. They're fucking awesome, and everybody supports each other. Yeah. And it's just why I loved music in the first place, you know, the togetherness of it all. And also on a shit day, I've had a couple of rough days over the last few. I mean, I've had a fabulous time. It was my birthday a few days ago, so I've been spoiled rotten. But I did have, you know, I've had a lot go on, and I've had a very, very heavy start to the year. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'll still tap into it. I'll go back to the music I listened to when I was 12, 13 that got me out of feeling rough. And it still does. It still has the power.
If it's not too personal, like, what was that music?
Well, it's funny because I was 12, 13. So I found myself, I have been listening to the Everclear so much for the Afterglow album.
Oh,
kind of on loop. It's so fucking good.
It's so good. Oh my God. I haven't listened to that in 15 years, probably.
Exactly. But if you had the album sitting on your shelf, you might actually stumble across it. But because
I still have my suitcase of CDs. I do.
Oh, amazing.
It's literally in my closet. I'm going to go whip that out tonight. Wow. What else? This is a fun game. What else was,
Well,
was there
Rancid's Outcome the Wolves was an album that I think, you know, I was about 12 when I got it, and it just was intoxicated. All the distortion and the resonance and the major chords and the melodies and the anthemic nature of the melodies, mm-hmm. the words, the meaning in the words, it all just hit the spot. And it's not something I haven't listened to those albums in years,
right.
But I was like, fuck, I'm not finding anything that's hitting the spot. I need distortion. I need adrenaline, yeah. I need energy, I need melodies. And I was like, let's try it. And it worked. Wow. So it's great. It's been fucking amazing.
That's interesting because all the things that you just described, I mean, I'm a hot minute older than you. And when I was 12 and 13, I was listening to a lot of, again, energy, distortion, but it was in a different level. It was Doors, Led Zeppelin.
Yes.
I was listening to the stuff that, you know, my older brother was into and trying to, you know, figure out why that music connected with me on such a level that I was just like, everything else is crap. And I just want to listen to this all day.
Yes.
And it, again, it's like, it's, you know, that adrenaline and that distortion. And maybe it was just part of our rebellion as coming in as a young woman. Of a certain age, but I find that very interesting that there's that parallel.
I mean, we should hang. Next time I'm in Florida, I'm coming down for
please
a drink.
Do. Well, I'll just come out yeah, I mean, with you. By the way, sorry I missed your birthday. that looked exciting. Again, because since we're having a therapy session here tonight, when it comes to birthdays, do you tend to look back on the year that was and learn from it? Or do you specifically look ahead to what could be in the next year?
Oh, wow, interesting. I think it's always a process. I do, you know, I started making music very young, and as I was saying, you know, sensitive. So I was touring very young. I was running my businesses very young, and I was comfortable in doing that. But also, you know, you have relationships that don't survive touring. You have all sorts of things that happen. You're far away, you're constantly in different places. And so I think that all the things I was saying at the beginning in terms of managing time, managing feelings, managing several businesses at the same time, I ended up being relentless about my time management, relentless about what every day looks like, what my routines are, what my 3 months need to look like. And, you know, well, more so as an adult. I mean, that was because everything at that age just came very naturally. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I still
can't do that. That's why I'm just like, like, what? This is amazing. Keep going. Sorry.
No, all good. I appreciate that. You know, I mean, I do different talks on like creative entrepreneurship. And I think that something a lot of people struggle with is switching minds, switching brains all day long. It's exhausting. And I've done it for so long. That I was like, it's very inefficient. How can I've just very enjoyed optimization. I also never wanted to feel anxiety again that would get in the way. So through my teenage years, I was like, I refuse. So I kind of went through solutions, which is so kind of in what we were saying about songwriting. I went through every part of songwriting and broke down. If you start with the lyrics, what might you get blocked on? And how can you get through that? If you start with the beat, what might you get blocked? And how do you get through that? You start with an instrument. And so I think for every part of life, what I'm trying to say is I've tried to be very deliberate about being able to live the fullest, freest life possible. And it can be difficult when you take on a lot of work, but I think it's very important to be very self-aware of your hang up, the things that waste time, the things you get caught up on, and also have a clear vision of where you're going, which I still have to re-up on that. You know, I did it and I've not looked at it for a couple of weeks. I'm like, yo, don't forget that. So this is a really poor answer to your question because it's incredibly wordy, but I would say both, but I think it's an everyday thing. Every day I'm kind of assessing.
You're like working it like a muscle.
Yes.
That muscle memory of I have to continue to do this in order to be able to do this and not have this anxiety come back down again. So you're like protecting your space by constantly reevaluating.
Yeah, and the anxiety is something that I haven't, you know, I was in therapy for 10 years and then I did all sorts of shit. And one day I was like, how is it that I've been in therapy all my teen years, like 10 years, and I still have this issue? And so I went deep into wellness and I just tried every form of alternative stuff. I managed to get rid of my anxiety completely and it hasn't come back. I feel pressure. I feel emotion, I feel things in life, but I don't have it the same way I used to, which is great. So I did get over that. And then I just got very into wellness, acupuncture, meditation, and different things. And then I think whenever you experience pain in life, if you find something that helps you, you feel compelled to share it with anyone going through that. And so, yeah.
Is that what your music does?
Now. I would love for my music to do that. And I find that, you know, I do talk about these things. I'll do, whether it's speaking on panels or, again, different talks on whether it's creative entrepreneurship or emotion or Web3. I found that if I try and put it all in my music, it takes away from the music. So I needed that outlet. I have a crypto page on TikTok where I teach people about blockchain tech and the uses of it and understanding it in different projects. And I found that calms me down, because I'm not then trying to cram all of my being just into the music. It's right. You need to diversify. Let everything have its moments. Yeah.
To use a financial term, we need to diversify our creative outlets here in the Jam Happy Hour. We are hanging out today, if you're just jumping in late, with Tatiana DeMaria, who is coming in from LA, hanging out, playing music, just kind of discussing where she's been, where she's going. We talked about influences. We talked about how we can kind of get into our own heads and get out of our own heads at the same time too. And then now I want to talk about this very strong, you're clearly a type A and driven. And I'm curious, where did you learn that? Like, was there someone in your circle as a child that kind of showed you that you can be this way? Or was it just something that you came by naturally?
That's a very good question. That's the second time someone said that to me in 2 days as well, which is interesting.
That's a sign.
I guess. But
I believe in signs. I'm weird like that.
Oh, no, I'm massive hippie. I'm 100% with you. Okay. Yeah. That drink's going to be good. But I reckon my parents, we grew up in London because my parents fled the civil war in Lebanon. They left in the middle of the fighting, and we were raised in England waiting for the war to end. And it was a 20-year war. So I think what my parents definitely did was, growing up, they taught us love and acceptance for everyone and everything. And they were always wanted. My mom is, like, we joke that she fell in the magic potion as a kid because she's very, very loving. She's like Mother Nature. Until she's not, and she'll totally fuck someone up. But she's really, really sweet and loving. And my dad is a complete clown, super funny. And I think that there was always an element of being yourself. So we're all kind of nutters in my family. However, I think my mum did, you know, want me to be a princess. And she kept trying to stuff me in dresses. And, you know, I was touring. I was doing Warp Tour. She came to LA to celebrate the release of my first album. And I, shit you not, was like, went out to buy me a pink tutu with ballet flats. And I'm like, Ma, like, how do you not know?
To be funny or to be
No, she's still trying to get me in ballet flats and tutu, no joke, pink. And I'm just like, this doesn't make sense. She's adorable. So there's that. But I think I definitely grew up as a bit of the, they used to call me the bulldozer as a kid. And I was at school. I mean, I appreciate it. I think I definitely just was not comfortable with certain norms and just ended up feeling compelled to do what was aligned with me. And I think that what I was to prioritize kind of joy in a way in watching my parents, because they'd been through so much. And then we went back to Lebanon towards the end of the war. And I spent a lot of time growing up in Beirut and in a post-war Lebanon. It's a very different experience. A country that's come out of 20 years of war is experiencing bliss, is experiencing humanity in a very different way. I actually do think that whatever soul happened to inhabit this body was pretty fucking determined to do whatever it was going to do, and I'm just along for the ride.
I think that's a pretty awesome way to describe it. My 12-year-old will not touch pink or tutu or flats either, so she wants to be in Doc Martens and hoodies and any color but. So I applaud it, and I love to see it. And
what was your mom like?
My mom, she was very type A. She was handling all the business. When she was just a bank teller, she was handling the business at home. And then she eventually became a vice president of a bank and became super successful and power suits and, you know, all the Bobby Brooks stuff too. So I got to see her be a little bit of everything and really make her way up in a man's world with finance and banking, you know, much like yourself. So that was what I watched every day, walk in and out the door. And yeah, I would definitely say it absolutely 100% affects me. I'm terrible with my investments, though, and she gives me crap about it all the time. I'm like, I hire a guy. And she's like, no, get in there. So we are working on that together. So she's teaching me a little bit more of that, which is really kind of fun to do now that, you know, we're older and, you know, we've got my daughter watching at the same time, too. So I think that female energy is definitely obviously a massive influence being our moms, but teaching us how to be individuals, too. I think it's a thread like no other.
It's true. It actually made me think that, I mean, I fucking love that, and props to your mom and you. And I think that, I think that I also have that with my dad. My dad was definitely, I realize I'm a lot like him, but in work, I think I learned a lot from the way he worked and the way he worked his way up and what he's done. So yeah, there's some of that too.
Isn't it crazy when you can kind of get to a point and look back on it and like we thought our parents were nuts and crazy, and then you realize that you've picked up all these little things along the way and like you've become a pretty good blend of the good and the bad. I mean, nobody's perfect. I definitely have my dad's temper and I've got my mom's irritability and you know, goals, I should say. But it at the same time, it's kind of fun to look back on and go, you're all right. You're okay. And we can still sit around and listen to like a ton of music together. Like she's into Motown and we'll crank that up in the house and just dance around.
Yes.
And coming back to the theme of like music will always bring you together. And, you know, you get to do that. You get to make that, which I think is the coolest thing. I can talk all day long, but I can't play a single instrument. I can sing a song badly in the car, preferably by myself, but I thoroughly enjoy it. What is it like? How does it feel to perform for people, knowing that they're taking in everything that you're giving out?
Oh gosh, that's interesting. Well, shout out to Zach and Jonathan Judas in the comments as well, and Andrew, in terms of people receiving. I think it's interesting because it's much like someone saying something nice to you about your presence, or you walk in the room, or you're funny, or whatever, and it's hard for you to understand that or see that. There comes a point in life where your friends might give you a compliment and you just go, I don't know how to relate to that, but I appreciate it. And I'm just going to try and store it. So I think the experience recently has been playing here and seeing people's comments is amazing. Again, the fan club, the social club that I have, which we've kept very small, very intimate, because I actually am very much enjoying it this way right now. And it's something we talk about a fair bit. It's really nice because there is that intimacy and there is that connection. Live, the best thing is when people are singing your songs back to you, because then that's your way of understanding how they're receiving and that they are receiving. Mm-hmm. It's the energy in the room that I love, and that's when you feel the most connected. And I'm playing a show in New York on May the 30th at the Mercury Lounge, and I look forward to feeling that again. Aside from that feeling and understanding, like having them reflect energy back to you and seeing them move or seeing them sing, I remember one tour I did a long time ago when at every stop, someone came up to me and said, your album, Soho Lights, like this song or this song or the show, whatever it was, they were like, it saved my life, or it got me through addiction, or different things happened. And I think that's when it really sinks in. Otherwise, you're just kind of making music and putting it out in the world and then watching people relate in comments and things. And it's great. But it's harder to get that intimacy and really know until you're with people in person or you create intimate setups like the fan club.
And I'm sure as you being, you know, empathetic to vibes and feelings, that has to be a very big wave coming at you all at once.
Yeah, I mean, it's awesome. And we started our career, you know, again, I was a teenager and would play to 8 bar staff and 3 people here and 4 people there. And there were very few women playing guitars. And I just don't really care who you put me in front of, whether it's, you know, we talked with Alice Cooper and people were like, I don't know, his fans are really hard. And I'm like, gimme him, you know? And it was great. It was fucking amazing. And so for me, it really is just about when you're on stage, there's 2 things that happen, I think. Number one is you're playing music and you're letting people in, your songs, your words, your experience. Mm-hmm. But it's not for me just about standing there and just letting people in. It's about reading the room, reading their feelings, connecting with them. I love staring people in the eye. I love going into the crowd and connecting with people and seeing the look on their faces. And I talk through my set and I stop songs halfway through my set. And it really is about whatever the fuck's happening in the room at that time. Because it's an experience. It's not just a
You're not rolling through a set list in your, you know, your mind. Like, and not saying anything negative because I don't want the backlash. But I recently went to see Taylor Swift with my daughter. And you talk about presence and set list and experience, and everything is planned out to the moment. And you have to think, I mean, I'm sure they're not all the same. They're certainly not all the same because she changes songs here and there. But when you have such a production at that level, there are so many people and things and marks and songs and lights and hits that need to be done at a certain time. You don't really have that freedom, like you said, to be in that moment, to be literally eye to eye experiencing that with that person and that person and that person. Like it gives you that freedom to just kind of go where you need to go.
Yeah. And freedom is absolutely my core driver in life. So someone said to me once, you know, what's your ideal of how you would be as a musician? And I was, if you just give me a guitar, stick in the desert by myself, I'll be okay. Do I want to make my productions and my beats and all the things that come out and the genres that I release? Because it's obviously not just acoustic. I mean, it's not acoustic, but I do additional acoustic stuff. Yes, but for me, it's about the truth and it's about melody. And that's kind of the beginning, middle, and end. And it doesn't matter if we're in a bar or in an arena. I have seen shows where it's felt like a production and it has been the same show every night. And when I get the second time, I suddenly go, oh, that wasn't magic. That was actually planned. And so I think we all do it. You know, when you play 200 shows a year, there is going to be overlap. I might crack some same jokes occasionally and different things, but because they're on the top of my mind at the moment. But I love the idea that if you come to 5 shows, I want those 5 shows to be different.
So the show's coming up in New York, which is exciting. Plans to do more touring, more live music. Seems like everybody and their mother is out right now. It's like everybody's
jealous.
All the tours.
So I've got a bunch of music coming out this year.
Y'all hear that? I'm waiting for the comments.
Yeah, there's some singles, there's EP, there's album coming, there's music videos. So we have things lined up for the next 6 months, which is great. And then more after that, for any crypto nerds in here, there's also an NFT drop coming soon. But I think that because I'm one person who's, again, creating the music and then planning the tours and running the businesses and different things, I am trying to manage that. So what I think I might do is play this show in New York. It's a record release party. Mm-hmm. Keep releasing music and do one-off shows and build up. I want to build up momentum again. I want to get in touch with all our fans again as the new music comes out, and then start scheduling bigger tours where I can be completely present in the tour and not thinking, fuck, we're doing this tour, but I need internet connection because this track's coming out and I haven't done the artwork yet and I haven't submitted this. And, you know, so it's just about managing that.
Well, yeah. And I know that we now know this is very important to you to be able to manage everything in its place, because that's how you get it done and you get it done right. Again, the fastest music hour. I know we are almost out of time.
Jeez, you were right. I mean, conversation's great.
Songs.
Sorry, guys.
I think we got time for a few more, but I'm going to shut up for a second. And what song would you like to play for us next here in the Jam Happy Hour?
Good question. Guys, hit me with a song. I'm gonna give it a few seconds, see if something comes in.
I love it. They're like right there.
Oh, Kelly Wollishin, thank you very much. I appreciate that. I'm very excited about the Mercury Lounge. I think it'll be wonderful.
It's such a great venue too.
Debaucherous night. Yes. Yeah.
Debaucherous.
Oh, Sarah Elizabeth. You know
great
what?
Word.
Good point, Sarah. Because I wasn't gonna play that, Sarah, but now I feel like, okay. This is the song that's coming out on May the 19th. I don't know if my voice is going to manage this. The recording of it sounds completely fucking different. So let's give it a shot.
Great.
Let's go a bit lower for my voice. You got free speech, and I dare you to use it. Come get your personality free from a magazine. Cool. Would you give your life for a comma? Them bright lights will come up. I'm scratching at the surface. Tell me, is this all there is? And I'm waking up tired now from too much sleep. And I'm killing time while time kills me. It's all think, overthink, so uncomfortably numb now. Mental masturbation, now you just don't come numb. Throw my head back open wide. Singing la 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 la. Wash the lights out. Fucking hell, these headphones, my bad. Changing keys. Throw my head back. Open wide, singing la 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 la, and push the lights out from my eyes, singing la 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 la. Lose you, think I just can't swim. The ink is thick, the whip I'm in. Throw my head back, make me blind, singing la 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 la. Oh, oh, la. Still a cry of the faithful, and the story's still told. The consumers are waiting, and oh, I don't wanna fall in love. I don't wanna find you out, looking for oblivion. I'm looking for a way. And I'm tired now from too little sleep. And I'm killing time while time kills me. It's all think, overthink, so uncomfortably numb now. Mental masturbation, now you just don't come now. Throw my head back open wide. Singing la 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 la. And push the lights out from my eyes. Singing la 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 la. And lose you think I just can't. Swim. The ink is thick, the paper thin. Throw my head back, make me blind. Singing la 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 la. 26, stuck with 16. I'm a dope fiend, thinking every man a free spirit. Without a dream, I'm a city that never sleeps, is fast asleep. LCD screen, 6 inches from me, inkies. I make mistake now. Trying to feel a quick sell me something. More land of the free and the city that never sleeps is fast asleep. Whoa, oh, oh. If you're a model, am I supposed to wanna fuck you? And if I'm high, am I supposed to feel like I'm alive? And if love really is the highest of the high price, will I pay you to lose it? Throw my head back open wide. Sing la 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 la. And wash the lights out from my eyes. Sing la 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 la. And lose you pain, I just can't swim. The ink is thick, the paper thin. Throw my head back, make me blind. Singing la 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 la. Oh, oh, la 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 la. That one needs some work. Acoustic. Fucking hell. Hey, Jackie. Thank you very much. T Cappy, what's up? Oh, T Cappy, I have a song for you. Let's see. Can't wait to jam this in the car. Fuck yes. I mean, acoustic, it needs a little work. The recording, very excited about dropping that. There will be a video as well, May the 19th, guys. Stay tuned. T Cappy, this one's for you. Your absence doesn't make my heart grow fonder. I won't miss you more and more, yeah. Saying infatuation drives me crazy. Not no one but myself can save me, cause I don't wanna love you, and I don't wanna miss you more and more and oh yeah. You're scratching up my skull and pulling on my heartstrings. I miss you like I miss bullet for a bee sting. You're setting bones off, I'm setting under my skin. Drugs they're walking now, begging for replacements. And
what you wanna do and what you wanna say. Slipping on the street only goes one way. Try to just in that podcast for sure. Oh, I can take it anymore, yeah. Cause I don't wanna love you. And I don't wanna miss you more and more and more. And I don't wanna love you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Lust for you, yeah. Lose my mind over you. Ooh. I'm like those people who just sit there and they stare at you blank. Get up for you to think what the fuck's been on day all my lately. And what you wanna do and what you wanna say. Gonna be outbreak, gonna be passion, wouldn't know unless you ask them. So what they're thinking is, hey, I don't look like this 24/7. Give me 1 second, I just won't get another expression right. And some might have to fail with my personality. Give me a reason not to share.
I'm gonna need the name of that one.
Hang on.
That was my really bad. Good. I need that on my Spotify. I need that one on my playlist for sure. I want to hear the name of that last track. It was
I Don't Wanna Love You, and that's actually under, it was also on the first album. It's Tat, T-A-T. So if you go to Spotify and you type in Tat and then Soho Lights, you'll find the band. And then there's an acoustic version of that too.
Isn't that crazy how like tech has changed so much? That it used to be like you would have to go to the record store and you'd have to get the cassette or the album or like whatever your medium was, and now it's like I can go on my phone, I can go to Spotify, I can look up Soho, it's like, and boom, it's right there. Like, that's kind of awesome.
It is.
And the fact that we get to hang out like this is also kind of awesome. But at the same time, too, there's something to be said about, you know, putting a needle on a record and hearing the scratch of how it was recorded. And I don't think we're missing any authenticity in your music and your experience whatsoever. Do you have a preference on how people hear your music like that? It's like, do you visualize, and I'm big into visualization, but it's like, do you visualize people like headphones on, walking through their day-to-day life? Like, where do you see people listening to your music? Bad question.
Oh gosh.
I'm still curious.
No, it's cool. I think it's funny. I don't think I do.
That's an answer in itself.
Yeah. Maybe that's very fucking self-centered of me that I'm just
focusing
on the music.
You did all the work already. You made the song. You don't know me.
I mean, I think I've been terrible at visualization, and it's something that I.
We could work on that together. I'm good at visualizing it. You're really good at making it happen. But I will always sit back and be like, okay, what do I want? How do I see this going? visualize it, bring it into existence. Like, all right, exercise. Have you played your dream venue yet?
No, I mean, I do have visualizations around that. And I do actually do subconscious reprogramming around visualization as well. Okay. And I agree with you 100%. And you've got to be able to see it. But I found that that's one of my practices. It's kind of one of the first practices to suffer when things get hectic and overwhelming, and I'm aware of it. So I'm like, motherfucker, no. But I do, yeah, there are some venues, and I do, I guess I picture it live. Come to think about it, in visualizing, it is always live. It's always playing a live show. It's always being in the room. So yeah, Saskatchewan, Kelly, Wallachian. I mean, I've played Saskatchewan for the fabulous time. I don't remember the name of the venue in Saskatchewan, but we were in, yeah.
Well, you have toured. You've toured extensively, and you have played some major festivals. You have played, you know, with the band solo. I'm not going to ask preferences or this, that, and the other. But if there's one takeaway from having to be able to have been all these places and experience all these things and all these different artists, what is something that you've taken from that experience that makes you better at what you're doing now? Because we all got to learn something through every road we walk through. Like, there's a reason why we went through it. The good, the bad.
Absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, there was a time when we had been touring for so long that I just felt like I was just a performing robot going on stage. And I was like, this is not how I want to show up. And I think that I do feel like if it doesn't feel good, you're not doing it right. And I think that that applies to everything in life. If you're in a relationship, it doesn't feel good, you're not doing it right. Either you guys aren't compatible or you're not showing up right. If you're doing a job and it doesn't feel good, you're not doing it right. It either means you're not in the right job or you're not in the role you want to be in, or you're just having resistance. Exactly. So I think that it was really burning out through, we did like 1,000 shows on the same album. And I was just like, it's a lot. I needed to stop. So I think there was learning that balance, obviously different cultures. You know, it's wonderful to see different people, how they operate, exploring different parts of different countries has been magical. Eating food everywhere is all I think about at all times. So, you know, that's awesome. That was cool too. there's a person in here, Leanne, who I know is a baker and sends me baking images on Instagram, which is dope. So one day in person, Leanne, I'd like a cake. Thank you very much.
There you go.
But yeah, I think it's just experience in life. One thing I did learn with a band, though, I mean, there are so many things I learned being in a band that I found all businesses are the same. And I think everything parallels. And running businesses, founding businesses, whether it's in tech, whether it's in music, whether it's in crypto, whatever it is, it's always the same. And I think something I learned very young was something in the hiring process, for example. You can have a wonderful bass player, drummer, and they're great and love them, but it's really about getting people on board who are good at what they do and want to do that thing. And that's something I found in the corporate world doesn't align so much. So if there's two main things I'll take from, I guess, just doing that, it would be number one, the hiring process. Make sure that whoever you're hiring, not only are you hiring them for the right job that they want to be doing, but you're not hiring them for one job and expecting them to do 5 other things just because they can and just because they're there. Like, that will just create resentment, animosity. Yes. So it's like, it's the metaphor.
Again, for the back. Jesus. There's so much of that today. And for you to have just pinpointed that, that's beautiful, because it's going to steal the joy from the experience for them, which is going to steal the joy from the experience for you and for your fans. That's huge.
And you're not going to get the best work. And again, in corporate environments, it's the same thing. You know, it's people showing up to do a job and they can get unhappy or they can feel like lifted and they're growing. And the second thing, and then they want to give value, right? The second thing is, as a musician, you know, a lot of people get very excited about music and a lot of people want to do things in music. And a lot of corporate companies or labels or people will talk to you a lot about doing things. And another thing I found is that as an entrepreneur, going through so many opportunities as you do, whether it's play this concert, play this festival, here's an investor, here's a label, you go through so many of these that as an entrepreneur, I think it definitely equipped me to be able to read a situation very quickly and understand immediately if this was something worth pursuing or not, which is tremendously important for valuing your energy, your time, and, you know, not hanging on. Like, I see a lot of artists being like, I just want the label to sign me. I'm like, why? They're going to turn around and say, go grow your TikTok. So why don't you go grow your TikTok anyway, and then get a better deal with the label later down the line if you want one.
I think we're new best friends, honestly. Everything that you're saying is so on point, and your time and your energy has been fantastic. I'm going to ask for a little bit more of it, because I would love to get one more song out of you before they kick us out of this joint.
Absolutely.
What would you like to play for us last year in the Jam Happy Hour?
Let's see. These questions are fire, by the way. Ashley Jackson. Aww. Jana, I'm fucking loving the questions. I'm loving the discussion. It's wonderful. And thank you.
Me too. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you, Ashley.
Yeah, that's right, people.
We should do it again.
Well, what?
We should do it again.
Oh, fuck yeah. I'm in. okay, let's see. And we're going to see how the voice holds up for this one. Also, you said happy hour. This isn't water. This is tequila.
Atta girl. Almost Cinco de Mayo. Why not?
Headphones. Thank you, Seth. See how they fucking look out for me? It's amazing.
I love it.
It's amazing. All right, guys. Let's give this a shot. Really happiness. I'm in the middle of starting another song. We going old school, or are we going make me feel? I'm giving you guys one shout at this, because we're over. First answer wins, maybe. Ah, okay. Okay, I just realized I forgot how the fuck this starts. Great. You know I want you. Your legs wrapped around my waist. Oof. You know I want you. Your legs wrapped around my waist. I could have loved you like nobody else. But you tried to play your hand at a game I'd abandon. Drag it out for far too long, till I'm wondering how it started. I won't even walk out, caught here, still man, I can't stand the tease. I ain't even on ya, caught here, caught in the chase. You make me feel, yeah, you make me feel, make me feel. In the blackout curtains, blind, falling in deep air. High above the city light, met you in a hotel bar. This should be fun for a night. I keep walking through that door, coming out on the same side. I won't even walk out, caught here. Still, man, I can't stand the taste. I ain't even on ya, caught in the thrill of the chase. And you make me feel, yeah, you make me feel, you make me feel. Elbow, steel, when I'm all in. Elbow, steel, when I'm all in. I've done better drugs, I have a stronger love, I have a dirty lust that we just don't touch, darling, same love. It's potent lust and it's just enough to keep me hooked. Want the interrupt, the unorthodox, the self-afflicted mass chaos. You're not one to trust, though you got me caught between my weakened heart and the tip of your tongue, yeah. Ooh, ooh. I wanna hold you, but not for the rest of my life. I wanna own you, 'cause my jealousy is right. Darling, if you're not by my side, you must be fucking someone else. I wish I hadn't met my match. Look at how I played myself. I won't even walk out. Caught here. Still, man, I can't stand that tease. I ain't even on ya. Caught here. Caught in the third of chase. And you make me feel. And you make me feel. You make me feel. Jen and Nicole, I love seeing you sing along. Fucking awesome. Jackie, thank you. SB, thank you. Chuck, thank you very much. Appreciate that. JJ.
Amazing.
Glad to have you in here.
Perfect ending. Not that I wanted to end, but that was spectacular. Thank you so much for your time and your honesty and your energy and your talent this evening here in the Jam Happy Hour. If you weren't already a fan, though many of you are already, of Tatiana DeMaria, please like, share, tell everybody about it, put it on your playlist. It really is so important these days just to support the artist and the talent that they're putting out there for everybody. And I am going to be so excited to watch what you are up to next, because I can definitely tell you are not slowing down one little bit.
Thank you very, very much. I second that. Thank you to everyone who's tuned in. Feel free to share it, big it up. Thank you so much for hanging out, all the lovely comments, the kind words. Looking forward to playing more and seeing you guys in May in New York for the show at Mercury Lounge on the 30th. Also, a new track dropping on May the 19th. And Jana, you have been absolutely wonderful. Thank you for such thoughtful and insightful questions. Thank you for your love energy and making this such an hour for me as well. And I look forward to our paths crossing again soon. And again, thank you for your support and kind words and having me. It means a lot.
Absolutely. I can't wait to do it again. Cheers to you. And onward and upward.
Onwards and upwards.